true believers, this is Doc Hogg, and welcome to episode 53 of Comics and Variety. If you like this channel, please do subscribe, hit the notification bell to be notified when I post new videos, and for the sake of YouTube's search algorithm, please do hit the like button. Alrighty, we'll get to Vagrant Queen in just a minute, but first I have this very important message for you. Okay, my friends. You and I, we need to sit down and have a chat, which means that I'm actually going to come to your house and talk to you about why you have not yet backed Tales from Nerosville issues 1, 2, and 3. There are only about 24 hours left on its Indiegogo campaign. They are written by Jason Meadows, a contributor to this channel and a completely awesome guy. You get 3 hard copy comics for only $11. That includes the shipping. Only $11. Alrighty. So do yourself a favor and back these comics and don't make me become a stalker. I will provide a link to Tales from Nerosville's Indiegogo campaign in the description below. Alrighty, moving on to Vagrant Queen. It was written by Magdalene Mags Visaggio, formerly known as Brian Visaggio, and thankfully our boy Greatlot read Vagrant Queen, so Doc Hogg didn't have to. Well, then the SyFy channel got the bright idea to make it into a TV show, so I figured I had to read Vagrant Queen to see what was so great about it that it actually found a producer. And at the end of it, I'm kind of left wondering, did I read the right Vagrant Queen? So let's start with the plot of this comic. The protagonist is a woman named Elida, who was a princess until her mom, who was the queen, was overthrown by a coup. Well, she meets up with some dude named Isaac, who tells her that he knows where her mom is. Presumably her mom's been missing. And so, you know, that's our plot. A former princess named Elida teams up with Isaac to find her mom. Wait a minute. There's more to it. Isaac agrees to help her in exchange for getting his ship back, which he claims Elida stole. At any rate, she agrees, so they are off to the planet Wix, to a monastery on the planet Wix where he claims her mom is. But there's more to the plot. Isaac is a double agent working with the Republic, specifically someone named Lazaro Ori. Mr. Ori has struck a deal with Isaac to get him back to the planet Earth and his wife, if he brings Elida to Wix. Presumably that is so Mr. Ori can capture Elida and bring her to a trial and execution, which is what he has been ordered to do by the government. But when Elida gets to Wix, she is stung by some little insect and the venom gives her hallucinations. And the artwork here makes it look like a robot insect. So if it is a robot insect, presumably it was Mr. Ori who sent the robot insect. But then why not use the robot insect to subdue her and capture her? I mean, maybe he doesn't want to, or maybe it is just a regular insect. But the way it is drawn is confusing. You know, nice artwork. And then Elida is captured, ends up at a monastery where she meets Mr. Ori, who tells her he has found a little stone called the Bezoar, B-E-Z-O-A-R, if you care, that gives him the power of mind control. And then Mr. Ori gloats about it. Ah, is that it? No, there's more. So Mr. Ori leaves Elida and Isaac on Wix to die. He doesn't kill them. He goes back to his world where he takes it over with the Bezoar by, of course, controlling everyone's mind. And Elida and Isaac escape and go back to Mr. Ori's world where they defeat him. So, here is the plot. A former princess named Elida teams up with Isaac to find her mom, but Isaac is a double agent who is leading her to her death at the hands of the government dude Lazaro Ori. But when Mr. Ori has a chance, he doesn't kill her because he was really trying to find this mind control stone called the Bezoar, and he brought Elida to Wix so he could gloat about finding it. Lazaro, or Mr. Ori, uses the Bezoar to take over his world, but Elida and Isaac defeat him. So, that's the plot. A bit difficult to follow, huh? I almost feel sorry for the person who has to turn this into a script for TV. It's absurd to the point that I have to say that I can't understand why anyone would make Vagrant Queen into a TV show. It just doesn't make sense. All right, well, next, let's talk about the plot holes in this book. And there are a lot of them. This is going to take a very long time. What?
I'm gonna go now.
What?
I'm gonna go now.
Oh. Well, looks like I can't be here for the next 5 hours, so I will only be able to discuss three of the plot holes. And lucky for me, two appear on consecutive pages. First, she after Elida lands on Wick, she runs into Isaac and shoots him. Now, where did this particular Isaac come from? He wasn't on her ship because she had kicked him off previously. Did Mr. Ori bring him here? And is he some sort of robot? That is, you know, he's not the real Isaac? Because Isaac is alive later on in the comic book. Now, maybe if, you know, Elida had just winged him and he ran away, it might make sense. But that's the type of wound that, you know, you don't get up from. Was it a hallucination? Well, she doesn't get injected with the hallucinogen until the next page, so if it's a hallucination, we have a little problem with the timeline. And after shooting Isaac, Elida kind of sums it, you know, pretty much sums it up here. You know, indeed, what the hell was that? Then there is the hallucinogen itself. Where did the insect, assuming it's an insect and not a robot insect, where did it come from? And what I mean by that is that there is no warning that this is a danger on Wix. You know, maybe if Isaac had previously warned her that there are dangerous insects on Wix, you know, we wouldn't be saying, you know, what is this doing here? It wouldn't seem like it just comes completely out of nowhere. And, you know, I have to wonder, how do these hallucinations that Elida now suffers, I mean, how does that add to the plot? They don't, really. She just, you know, ends up going to the monastery anyways. It seems like, you know, nothing more than page filler. And here is the biggest plot hole. Why is Mr. Ori bothering to bring Elida here anyway? Does he need her to obtain the Bezoar? Well, no, he doesn't, because he already has it by the time he encounters her on Wix. It makes no sense to bring her here other than to let Elida know that he has the Bezoar. And these are only three plot holes. I mean, there's lots of them, and they're gigantic. I mean, they're so big that, you know, Ted Kennedy and Marlon Brando could walk through them side by side after a McDonald's bender. Big Mac. And, you know, again, I have to say that I can't understand why anyone would make Vagrant Queen into a TV show. It just doesn't make sense. Finally, what I want to talk about is the main character, Elida. Word to Mags, your protagonist needs to be relatable. And you can make a grouch relatable, but only if you use humor.
I was always hoping you'd die off and I'd get somebody in here who knew what the hell they were doing. Instead, you just keep hanging around like a doo-wop dago. Not in this lifetime, Sonny. Well, I think you're an overeducated 27-year-old version. I'd look down, too, if I was you. I knew you were a dipshit the first time I ever saw you. You're wrong, egg roll. I know exactly what I'm talking about. You're letting Click Clack Ding Dong and Charlie Chan just walk out with Miss What's-Her-Face. And you know why? Because you're a big, fat pussy.
Yeah, Clint Eastwood's character in Gran Torino is a mega grouch. But what he says often amuses us, so we relate to him. Plus, the movie opens at his wife's funeral. You know, we feel sorry for him. We you know, and thus we identify with him. Now, there is a scene in this comic book in which Elida sees the coup that overthrows her mom, the queen. She sees this as a little girl. And had this scene come, you know, at the beginning of the comic book, we might actually relate to Elida. We might feel some sympathy for her. But, of course, you know, no such luck with this comic book. This scene is put toward the middle of the comic after we've already established that we really don't like Elida at all. And then there's the other problem that, you know, she almost never loses a fight. And in fact, she almost never struggles in a fight, except for the fight with Mr. Ori. But other than that, you know, she defeats all of her enemies easily. She defeats Giant Chicken Man easily. She defeats multiple guards easily. And at the end, you know, Mr. Ori can't control her mind with the Bezoar because she knows that it has a fail-safe. so she doesn't have any real weaknesses. In short, she's a Mary Sue. So not only do we not like her, she's boring. So to sum it up, you have an absurd plot, big plot holes, and a main character that is about as interesting as watching Brie Larson on the big screen. And again, I have to repeat, I just can't understand why anyone would make Vagrant Queen into a TV show. It just doesn't make sense. Maybe one of my viewers can explain it to me.
Alrighty, that music means that it is time for Hogs Headlines, all the news that Doc Hogg wants to report on. Dateline, Marvel Comics' new sales model. Back in 2010, Marvel Comics published a comic book entitled Avengers, Children's Crusade, that had this scene in it.
How lucky can one guy be? I kissed her and she kissed me. Like the fella once said, ain't that a kick in the head?
Well, last week, Rio de Janeiro's right-wing mayor, Marcelo Crivella, banned the comic from the Rio Centro Bienal do Livro, a very popular literary festival in Brazil. Crivella claimed he was banning the book to protect children from what he described as sexual content for minors. You know, I actually pretty much agree with that sentiment, but I think it's the job of parents to protect children from that sort of thing, and really not the government. Anyway, the mayor's censorship backfired. It infuriated book lovers and biennial patrons who quickly ran to buy a copy. All the commotion helped sell out all copies of the comic book. Later, the Supreme Court in Brazil thankfully overruled the mayor. But more importantly, Marvel Comics now has a way to sell all of its tanking SJW crap. As you probably know, Marvel recently hired the infamous Zoe Quinn to write a Hellcat series. So here's how Marvel can keep Hellcat sales from going into the toilet. Put lesbian sex scenes in it, and then send a whole bunch of copies to Rio de Janeiro. Okay, that's all for now. Have a very nice day. Yeah, I don't know. I just don't get it.